So from the, they found themselves at pressure both from the east, from the west, as always, Frankish, Germanic tribes, which were different, and influence, and migratory tribes from the east, right? And this Slavic kingdom was formed ruled by a Frankish person called Samuel. There's not much that we know about it, but we know that there was one there. That's the problem with history at this time. It's based on chronicles, you know, writings by travelers. It's not very clear what it actually was. But there was a Slavic kingdom around there. It didn't last long, right? So we were talking about the Czechs. So the Czechs, an important landmark, of course, as I mentioned, is 850, the Greater Moravia, the Great Moravia, or the Great Moravian Empire, right, which is, well, not that great, but it existed, right, and again, it coincided with parts of today's Poland and the Czech Republic, which collapsed is when the Magyars came in, later, you know, becoming the Hungarians. So, again, the same process. An important moment, however, is the founding of the Persian Mislid dynasty, which is the first and only native dynasty in the Czech lands. And this was founded in the 9th century. Now, understand that what today we call the Czech Republic, or was called, or the state that was called Czechoslovakia, which united today's Czech and Republic and Slovakia, is composed of many historical regions. And for most of history, the Czechs, the Slovaks, lived in, there was no Czech Republic. It was these regions that had their own form of organization. And the two major regions were Bohemia and Moravia. Bohemia is actually comes from the name of a Celtic tribe called the Boii, B-O-I, right? And then hence Bohemia. And so, Bohemia remains for most of history an important, unit, and Moravia as well, right? These are the two major regions. You see the same thing in the case of Croatia, which also is actually, you know, the name Croatia never really represented what today we understand by Croatia. There are many historical regions of various kinds. Okay, so. Again, anyway, in the 9th century, we have the Persian Mislid dynasty, established local dynasty in the Czechs, in the Czech lands, let's call them that, in Bohemia, splitting from Moravian influence. Right? And another important moment here, speaking of Czechs and Polish, is that, well, again, where are these? Here are the Polans, or right, that were formed Poland. Here are the these Czechs, whatever, Bohemians, Moravians, whatever, are here. And they form at a certain point, let's say at 900 BC, you still have Greater Moravia, which kind of covers several of these tribes, but they will form competing, entities. So here you have 1000, the year 900, right? 900 is best, right? Because you have the Polans and you have Moravia, right? And it shows you that they were different, entities. Competing at certain points, but also cooperating. For example, the Polish state was founded in cooperation with some of these Moravian, Czech rulers, or Bohemian rulers. You would give your daughter for marriage to the other king, or marry their daughter, and so on, in order to form more stable alliances. So there's this interaction here. But this interaction was not only political, it was also cultural. And here I get into the point, which is the fact that we also raised the issue of the spread of Christianity. And the question for all these areas, for all these regions, was which Christianity to adopt, right? And in fact, Christianity spread to the northern Slavs here, right? We talk about the Poles and then the Czechs here, spread to far north from Byzantium, because this was the stablest power Byzantium, which had huge influence over the entire region and also cultural influence. And missionaries, Christian missionaries, came from here to Christianize these populations. The Slavs were not Christian, obviously. So it was a Byzantine Christianity that arrived there first. And the famous two persons who spread Christianity there were Cyril and Methodius. And you know about them because you know about the Cyrillic alphabet, because this was the alphabet that Cyril invented, developed, which was a Slavic, an alphabet for the Slavic language, right? And that's very important. Hence, many Slavic languages, in some Slavic peoples even today, use the Cyrillic alphabet. You've seen Russian, if you go to Serbia, if you go to Bulgaria, it's written in Cyrillic alphabet, okay? And that's very important. Now, this is also important because then you're going to ask, so how come the Czechs, the Polish, don't write in Cyrillic alphabet, but the Latin alphabet? And how come the Polish are, you know, Catholic and not Eastern Orthodox, right? Because this is the question, which is a question that is not only religious again. It's a question of to which sphere of culture do they belong? And it will be a crucial thing later on. Do they belong to the West or do they belong to the East? Right? And when you read the article by Milan Kundera, you saw how this important it is to make it very clear that we are part of this. We are part of Europe. Europe, which is, remember, not a continent because it doesn't end here like, you know, America and, you know, with the ocean, but Europe, which is more a sphere of civilization. Because how do you know where Europe ends and or begins, right? It's a sphere of civilization. So, this choice was very, I mean, it wasn't a choice, these Romans were crucial. And at this point, it wasn't clear. As I said, the missionaries came from here. They came from here, however, but they were closer to the Frankish tribes, and the Frankish tribes were Catholic, and from here came a different influence, and they were closer to Rome than to Constantinople. So eventually, although they had a Slavonic liturgy, meaning the worship was done in a Slavic language, that is gradually replaced by the Latin liturgy, which was, you know, the main type of worship in the Western Christianity in what would become the Catholic Church after 1056, after the schism. 1054, the schism between Western Christianity and Eastern Christianity. But at first it was in between. We didn't know. Okay, we talked about the Czechs, a few words about the Slovaks. Again, they are part of the same reality. The Great Moravian Empire, we just talked about this. But the Slovaks were a smaller population, and they, some of these Slovak populations, some of these Slavic populations, maintain their own identity or political organization, like the Polish formed their own princedom, the Czechs formed their own princedom, which the test was, will it survive? The test is always, does it survive the other populations, the other influx of migratory population, right? The Avars, you saw that there were Avars here, where are the Avars? Who are the Avars, right? They were dissolved, conquered by other people, forces, and culturally dissolved by others, right? Well, that didn't happen to the will later become the Polish, didn't happen to the Czechs. The Slovaks, although they will maintain an identity, they will be conquered politically by the Magyars, which will be the Hungarians. And thus, the Slovaks, for most of their history, they don't have a history of statehood until 1918. But they will remain an ethnically distinct population from the Hungarians, because remember, the Hungarians, the Magyars, are not Slavic. So it's very clear that in a territory controlled by the Hungarians, by the Magyars, it's very clear who is not Magyar, because it's not Slavic, it's not like anything. So the Slovaks remain part of the Hungarian, but again, it's part of this, this is when this happens. Slovaks being too small, not having a political unit, they become dissolved. Czechs will have a kingdom, will have a dynasty. Now why is it important to have a dynasty? You're going to say, well, because, you know, they just give their throne to their sons and daughters and whatever. No. Dynasty was a means of maintaining what? Stability. Of maintaining continued rule over a territory. Here's a territory. Well, how do you maintain continued rule? Today, it's because we have a set of institutions that is perpetuated no matter who is in power. And we call that here in the United States what? Constitution. Well, you didn't have a constitution then, did you? The constitution was a way of life. So whoever took the power could become the person in power. So how do you mean? So, what is then a dynasty? It's a way of maintaining a continuity of authority. It's a way of maintaining an order within a territory. Because when someone dies, you know who's going to follow. Because if you don't know who's going to follow, there's a vacuum of power which creates chaos. Dynasty was the major, is the equivalent of today's elections in the United States, for example. Because you know how power, authority is passed from one generation to the next. So this is why this is very important. Okay, so we mentioned the Magyars, the Hungarians, so let's go and look at that. Remember, you know, you have Northern Slavs, Southern Slavs, and then peoples who are not Slav, right? Hungarians, Romanians who are Latin, Austrians who are Germanic, and so on. Okay, so the Hungarians, as I mentioned, the first wave was in 400, but that those were not Hungarians, although the name is a misnomer, they were the so-called Huns. And you've all heard of Attila the Hun, right? Let's see, if here's the Huns, right? Coming in this way. They were one of the, let's say 450 perhaps, it's better this way, Huns. There you have it. So the Huns in 450 AD, right? You see, well, it was a country, they had borders, you know, of course. What it shows you is how far their raids went, basically, right? But they don't last, because they don't establish lasting political institutions. What the key moment here is the year around the 10th century, around 900, right? Because this is when the Magyars, who seemingly came from somewhere in the Ural Mountains, and then lived somewhere around here, with the close to the Bulgarians, who were a tribe, also a migratory tribe. So the Hungarians eventually end here and settle in the area of sort of between today, that includes part of today's Romania, part of today's Slovakia, part of today's Hungary, part of today's Austria, and so on. So obviously, borders didn't exist as we understand them today. But this was a very well organized set of, you know, traditionally, what was it, seven tribes, right? And who signed a pact to come from, you know, after being separate for centuries, almost a millennia, in, you know, around the Ural Mountains, they signed a pact, and being pushed by other migratory populations, signed a pact to establish themselves here. And what they did is that they were successful, they were very successful militarily, just like the Huns, they raided Western Europe. And there was this famous prayer of "Save us, God, of the arrows of the Hungarians." So, just like the Huns. So you see how people in Western Europe had this confusion that, well, these are also Huns, right? So they settled here, and they also organized themselves politically very well. And also, just like the Czechs, the Polish, and they were at the crossroads here, and between two important forces: the Germanic tribes to the west, and migratory populations from the east, and also two cultural forces, Western Christianity, Eastern Christianity. Remember, by 900 you have a more established political units in Western Europe, which didn't exist for centuries. After the fall of the Roman Empire for three-four centuries, there was no stable center of power in Western Europe. There was no stable system of organization after, you know, about five centuries of Roman organization and rule. There was no. But now there is. So it's very important for all these principalities that are formed, or kingdoms, it's very important to define themselves in relation to these forces. And Hungary, as you see, with the Hungarians, when they establish their own political organization, it's very efficient, yeah, that which ensures that they will have a state. They will choose to ally themselves to, and to connect themselves to the West. And we're going to talk about the King Stephen, the first king who established the Hungarian state. We'll see how exactly this happened. But anyway, what's important is that they came from the east, settled in these areas, and the question will become the reason of much conflict, even today, is who was here first, right? So Hungarians would claim that they settled in, for example, in Transylvania, which is part of today's Romania. But they came, when they settled, there was no one there. Right? And Romanians claimed that no, there was an ancestral population there. So this becomes a huge deal in the 19th century, because again, where do you draw the borders? Which is mine, which is yours? Who decides? Yeah? Okay, so that's about the Magyars, the Hungarians. Then let's talk about, you know, speak of Romanians, let's talk about the Romanians. Now Romanians, their identity is claimed actually much, goes in Europe more further, at least, you know, in how it is claimed, than the Slavs or the Hungarians. Because Romanians claim their identity to be linked to a population that even the Greeks, ancient Greeks, knew, and basically as the Thracians. So for Romanians, you know, the history of the area, let's call it that one, right? Those who lived there were Thracians, but more than, and that's more the Bulgarians, were the Geto-Dacians. So this was a population around the west of the Black Sea, around the Carpathian Basin. And we're talking, you know, before 0 AD, right? Which was known by the Greeks, let's see. So 100, you see, 100 BC, you have the Dacians. Now, we don't know as much as we know about their culture. The point was that they were known by the Greeks, who exiled some people here by the Black Sea. And they're also known by the Romans. And this is important because I told you that Romanians speak a Romance, a Latin-based language. Well, why? Right. Why is it called Romania? From Roman, you see how the name, which a name that never existed, by the way, Romania, right, before the 19th century, didn't exist, right? So actually throughout our discussion up to the 19th century, we'll use, Romania is not a word that we can use, because it never existed as a word, right? It will be claimed. But what we'll have, you'll have three provinces, Transylvania, we're going to talk about this when we get to the year 1000. Transylvania, Moldova, and Wallachia. These were three princedoms that existed throughout the Middle Ages up to the 19th century. Okay, but anyway, let's go back here. So you have Dacians, and Dacians were, an older population there, which the Romans conquered, and that's the key moment. Around the year 100, this was a fairly rich territory, and the Romans wanted to conquer it, and you see they get up here, and some of the famous battles of the Romans were in 101, 102, with the Dacians, with the barbarians that they call the Dacians, who are a local sedentary population, not a migratory population. And the Romans win and occupy this territory. And notice that this is also the easternmost border, northeastern border of the Roman Empire, meaning right in the path of all these migratory populations, which means that there will be plenty of Roman garrisons there, which means that they will control. Now, do they control all of today's Romania? No, no, it's mostly the southern part, sub-southwestern part. And the rest was, we don't know how they were exactly, you know, tribes and so on. But the Roman control was mostly in the south and southwestern part. But it's because of this lasting Roman presence in this area that the Latin becomes the language. It's just with the French, which is a Latin-based, although the French, the original tribe, the Frankish tribe is Germanic. Why did French speak French? Meaning a Latin-based language, right? It's because of the Roman influence in that area, while the Germans do not speak a Latin-based language because the Roman influence did not reach that area, although both Germans and French, what we call today German and French, are from the same Germanic stock of tribes. Overimposed on local strata, like Gauls and so on. So the same happens here. So that's the key part of the history that you need to understand, that there are very clear there's still very clear evidence of the Dacians, and of their fights with the Romans. And if you go to Rome, to the Foro Romano, downtown Rome, you see a big column, Trajan's column, right? It's Emperor Trajan's column that he erected after his victories here. And he depicts the Dacians on the column. So now we know how the Dacians looked, because we have these depictions of bearded people with hats, with kind of pointy hats, whatever, kind of like the Smurfs. So we know that. So that's a strong evidence. The problem is that after the fall of the Roman Empire here, so let's go to 400. You see, this is the Roman Empire in 100. All that red spot. Then you have 400, you have the split between the Eastern and Western Roman Empire. 500. You have Byzantium. The point is that the Romans go away. Because the Roman Empire falls, what stays in place? Now that's a part about 300-400 years when we don't have clear evidence of who exactly is this population. Especially since you have all these migratory population, Gepids, Cumans,
you know, just going through the area Turkey, the Bulgarians go through this area. So what stayed there? Now, the you know, clearly the Roman Latin language remained, as Romanian today is Latin-based, very close to Italian. It's very easy to understand Italian if you know Romanian and vice versa, more or less, right? And Portuguese and whatever, and Spanish. So clearly that language, that cultural element of the language remains. So in the 19th century, the Romanians will define themselves, will call themselves Romanians, and will be proud of claiming this Latin heritage and kind of create a narrative in which Romanian is, was a mix of Dacians and Romans. That's basically the national narrative, okay? But this is why it is important. Now, of course, again, they, politically, nothing will exist, there will be nothing there autochthonous, local, until really 14th century, 13th, 14th century, when the first local rulers exist. Because what you have is the big force in the area is, you know, the Hungarians who will claim to will occupy, again, up to what is today Transylvania and even Moldova and so on, regions of later Romania, right? So this is the strong actor in the place. You don't have local actors, right? And the whole debate between Hungarians and Romanians, nationalistic debate, is about, well, who was here first, your state with my state with this state with, and so on. But you see how this is, you know, this rival, this debate is this tension between these states exists today because of these overlapping claims, and because this overlapping reality is much more complex than the lines we draw around it. This overlapping reality will give rise to very problematic borders, right, in the 19th, 20th century. Okay, enough about that. Let's go to the Southern Slavs. So the Southern Slavs, let's talk briefly about Slovenians. Right, the Slovenians, always a small ethnic population, come to the southern part of, so south of the Danube, basically, around the 6th century. Let's see if this is better. Probably not. Okay, it is better. 700. The point is that the Slovenes, who were kind of a distinct, you know, Slavic population, became a distinct Slavic population, was always small. And around the 8th century, so this is 700, but around the 8th century, the Slovenes, as much as they were distinct Slovene population, which have shared the Slavic history, you know, path with the other Slavic tribes, going down and whatever, part of the Greater Moravia, whatever. Well, they become associated, look how close they are to Bavaria, right? Here's the clash. These Slavs are the closest, with the Czechs, to the Western powers, namely to the Germanic powers, okay? So this is why Slovenes will actually become incorporated in many ways by the Bavarians, will be under the Bavarian cultural and political influence, although they will remain distinct because they had this, you know, Slavic language, the German is different, right? They will have a Slavic language, but being so small, they will, most of their history will be under Bavarian, then Austrian rule. And they only will become independent for the first time, well, will be part of the Yugoslavia in 1918, and will be only become independent in the 1990s. Okay? But it has always existed as an, you know, an ethnic entity. The Croatians, however, who also settled here, Croatians is more difficult. Again, Croatia, as I said, is actually what today we call Croatia, has many historical regions which at different points had different statuses. Dalmatia, the smaller Croatia, so to speak, Istria, and so on, right? Around here. So, and they all had different fates, or related, but not the same fates throughout history. It's kind of a gathering of regions, right? The point is that what is the origin, the ethnic origin of the Croatians? Well, first of all, clearly there is a strata that is not Slavic, because the Slavs settled here, but also seemingly one of the first tribes to settle here were the Sarmatians, which were not Slavic at all, and came from the today's region of Poland, settled here, and they formed a small state called White Croatia. They were not Slavic, right? But then, and then eliminated or displaced local tribes.
displaced. It means that they blended, and there was a culture that, you know, gained the upper hand. Think of the United States, how we all speak English now. Well, ethnically, we have many backgrounds, right? How many, you know, you will say, I'm of German ancestry, whatever, why don't you speak German, right? This is how it happens, this sort of dissolution and taking over of cultures. Okay, the Croats notice where they are. Again, they are very close to Italy, so they will fall within the Western sphere of influence. They will unsurprisingly become Catholic, just like the Slovenians, okay? And also will be closely associated with the Western parts. But again, at this point, it's still a battle between influences battle, a tension between influences from the East and from the West. In the 9th century, the Croatians established their first native dynasty, and that's very important, the Trpimirović. Again, it's important because dynasty means solid statehood. If it's only one ruler, no matter how powerful he is, the entity does not last, right? And which will rule over a Croatian principality, meaning he was a prince, the first ruler, which then becomes a kingdom. Now, who recognized someone as a prince or as a king, right? It was the Western powers. And it was the Western sources of authority. And one of the important sources of authority was the Pope. And the Pope, you know, being crowned, anointed by the Pope is basically the UN recognizing your statehood. And that's what happened in Croatia, that the king was recognized as king by other rulers, just like today other states need to recognize a new state. Right? Kosovo was recognized by many states, but not all of them, and UN doesn't recognize Kosovo yet. Right? Same was that, other states need to recognize it. In any case, there is a Croatia founded in the 9th century, so let's go to the year 900. There is Krobacia, it says there. Let's see how this map helps us. Okay, there is a sort of a Croatia. Okay, there is a more stable principality, a more stable kingdom by the 9th century, and you know it is Christianized and takes. So by the 10th century, you have an independent Croatian kingdom, which the Slovaks still never had. With the Slovenes never had. Don't confuse the Slovaks and the Slovenes. Okay, it's part of you knowing. Well, okay, Serbians. Now, Serbians is, you know, the opposite end. And this is, you know, remember the Serbians and Croatians were in a bitter war in the 1990s, right? The Yugoslav wars, right? This all tracks back here. A difference in identity. So Serbians settled with other Slavic tribes in the 7th century in the south of the Danube there. And create numerous small political entities, but two are more important. Dukja, because later it will form what today is Montenegro, never was, but today is Montenegro, and Raška, which will form the core of medieval Serbian state. Now, Serbia will have an important state in the Middle Ages, but not until then, so let's just say that they settled here, they don't have a strong political entity. Bosnia, and it's what today we know as Bosnia and Herzegovina, well, it didn't exist at that point. If this territory is basically this territory between what was Croatia, it is a misnomer, there wasn't really a Serbia here, right? Just to be clear. But there was a sort of a Croatia, let's look at the other map of the year 900. This is better, because it shows you that in 900 there is a Rašća, which is one of these principalities of the Serbs, and there was a sort of a Croatian principality, right? And in between them is what today we call Bosnia. Even back then it was in between them. And it will go under different rules. Either Serbian or Croatian, then Bulgarian, then Byzantine, and guess what? That will happen throughout its history. This is why in the 1990s it was one of the bloodiest scenes of conflict, because it was right at the intersection of different forces, of different powers. 1,000 years later. Okay, so, but Bosnia will have a noticeable political entity in the Middle Ages, so we'll see that next. And finally, although it's not part of our focus, but this is the moment when we have to talk about it, it's Bulgaria, or the Bulgarians. Because Bulgarians are a very interesting case. In the year
600, you see there's no Bulgaria here, there's Byzantine Empire, and there the Slavs are coming down and settling in this area, okay? There's the Bulgarians here, in the east of the Black Sea, okay? They will migrate, live for about a century in what is today Ukraine, and then come down to this current-day Bulgaria. They were not Slavic tribe, they were a Turkic tribe. But when they will come and settle south of the Danube, they were not enough of them to overtake the local population culturally. They will overtake the local population politically, militarily, and structurally, institutionally, but not culturally. And in fact, it was the Bulgarians who were culturally be assimilating the local population. But still, this distinction between Bulgarians and local Slavs was clear for a long time for the Byzantines, who had claims here. But that would become diminished and dissolved, guess what? When Bulgarians, just like Serbians, take up Eastern Christianity. And this is an important thing that I didn't mention with Serbians. That Serbia, the Serbians, will take Eastern Christianity. And I mentioned why that is important. Right? Because that will shape their identity very distinctly from, let's say, Croatians, who take Western. Besides the geographical, you know, distinction here, it's all, they speak, them speaking very similar dialects of Slavic, they will be culturally very different. One Western-oriented, the other Eastern-oriented. And this will shape their whole history, and the following 6-7 centuries will only reaffirm this, because guess what? All this area will be under the control of the Ottoman Empire, while all of this will not be. So it's very important, right? All these influences, one reinforcing the other. So the Bulgarians will settle here in the south of the Danube, will form a hugely powerful kingdom. There is Bulgaria. It was one of the most powerful empires for a couple of 3 centuries. Hugely developed, culturally flourishing. Attacking Constantinople. Constantinople could have fallen under the pressure from Bulgarian emperors, as your book makes it very clear. So huge, tremendous. But also takes up the Byzantine culture, and especially the, again, Eastern Orthodox religion. And that will be a key moment in creating a unified identity for this population, which was a mix of Bulgarians and Slavs. For 2 reasons. One, that the language of the church, of the Eastern church here, the language of the worship was Slavonic. Now, understand why is this important? Because it becomes the common language spoken in the most common activity, in the most shared activity, which is worship, in church. Okay, liturgy. It is huge. It's like, what is the language that you use at the whatever mayor's office when you apply for something? It's English. Now, you can speak at home whatever you want. What is the official language? What makes it official? That it's spoken in the institutions of the state. Now, at this point, what were the institutions of the state, meaning of this political entity? There weren't institutions that would cover the entire territory except for the court. There was the court, that's it. There was no standing military. There was the court, and there was the church. A structure of the church that spread throughout the country. And in all these churches, they spoke the same language, spoke the same text. That's a huge unifying factor. And a huge unifying cultural factor. And also education was happening there and so on. So Slavonic, the fact that they speak the same language, same religion, part of the same church structure, there is this common core to build an identity. So Bulgarian identity is intertwined with the Bulgarian Orthodox Church. Serbian identity, which will develop, will be intertwined with the Serbian Orthodox Church. This is how we know that the Serb is Orthodox. Okay, so that was a brief overview of the space up to the year 1000, basically, of the period. And the reason for having a video lecture before, besides your meetings, is to give you sort of some links between the different texts that you have read, to show you some commonalities, some factors that were shared and yet lived differently by these, you know, the same being the tension between migratory populations and Germanic populations in the West, and migratory from the East, between the Byzantine Empire and the Eastern Orthodox and Western Catholic, Western Christianity. All these forces were taking place here, but they were survived and lived differently for various reasons. Most of which, one of the most important being, do you have a strong state? Because if you have a strong state, then you can withstand external pressures. Then you can withstand
external pressures from the West, then you can create a unified space. Just like in Hungary, the king will Christianize, one of the kings will Christianize all the nobles by force if necessary, and it will also choose that no, we go with Western Christianity, and that will become a unifying factor. Okay, so it's very important. So this was just an insight. Tomorrow I will post the second part of the lecture, which takes again, this is an overview of the region from year 1000 to 1400.